Lori, that you're muted as a default, and then you have to unmute.
Yes. So welcome to the Mother Nature Network's first Hangout, the Year of Living Simply. We are kicking off this year-long event to help everybody simplify their life and experience the joy of less. So the first month, we are talking to Joshua Becker of The Minimalist, and he's going to help us declutter our life. So we'll sit tight for a couple of minutes and wait for people to join. But in the meantime, we're going to tee up some questions to Josh and have him start thinking about it. So, Josh, just some things to think about before people join. What inspired you to become a minimalist and to start a minimalist website?
Sure. Yeah, sure. My my story goes, I was cleaning out my garage, of all things. I was living in Vermont at the time, and I had been doing some spring cleaning. We got to the garage, and I was cleaning things out of the garage, just like I think most typical Americans would do. My son, who was 4 years old at that time, was in the backyard. He was playing on the swing, begging me to come play with him, and I'm like, I can't. I gotta take care of my stuff. You know, I gotta clean out this garage. It ended up taking hours. Started talking to my neighbor. Actually, started complaining to my neighbor about, you know, man, this is just taking so much time doing all this. I'd much rather be doing something else. And she's the first one that said to me, well, you know, my daughter's a minimalist, and she keeps telling me I don't need to own all this stuff. And I looked at the pile of things in my driveway, all dusty and cluttered and dirty. I looked at my son alone in the backyard, and I said, man, what am I doing? How much of my life am I wasting taking care of all these things that aren't bringing me any joy in my life, aren't bringing me any meaning? And that was the first step. I mean, that was the day that we said, I'm in, and we're going to go down this road getting rid of things that we don't need.
That's awesome. Yeah. So how did you have, like, kind of a count? Did you say, all right, we want to get down to 100 things in our house, or everybody gets to cut out, everybody's got to cut out 10 things, or what was your meter to say, okay, we are now minimalists?
Yeah, sure. I prefer to say I'm still becoming minimalist. I don't know if I ever get there. I feel like life is a constant journey of evaluation and adjustment and adding intentionality to it. I went online, started searching minimalism and finding out what this was and who was living this life, and quickly discovered people who were living with just 100 things, living out of a backpack, traveling the world. And immediately at the moment, I wasn't attracted to that. I didn't want to live with just 100 things. I didn't want to live out of a backpack and travel the world with my family. There were other things that I wanted to do and wanted to accomplish with my life. So I didn't set out with a number. I didn't set out with a goal of anything. I just set out with this blanket statement of, I'm gonna see how little things I can live with and still be happy and see, kind of experiment with this lifestyle a little bit. And man, the more and more we remove things, the more and more we began decluttering our home and decluttering our life, just the more value we found in it, the more joy we found in life and opportunities to pursue other things.
That's awesome. So kind of the whole, the things we own begin to own us mentality, and you kind of took control of that.
Yeah, and you know, it's funny because I'd heard that forever. I mean, that wasn't a new thought. That wasn't a new statement. I think I even mentioned it to my neighbor at the time. But I don't think I ever fully realized how much my things really were owning me. It was just more of a cute little cliche that maybe applied to really rich people, but didn't apply to me in my middle class life. Until we started getting rid of stuff and just finding out more and more the truth behind that statement. And I typically tell people they can't fully appreciate the joy of living with less until they actually begin experiencing living with less. We don't realize how much of our time and energy is committed to the things that we own until we purposely begin living with less of them.
That's awesome. So we've got a couple people that have joined us. We are live on air with Joshua Becker of TheMinimalist.com. If you guys have joined, you'll notice that you are muted by default. That way the background noise doesn't cut off the person who's talking. So if you have any questions, just click on the microphone at the top of your Hangout, and you can unmute yourself and ask some questions. So we talked a little bit about why Josh became a minimalist and what that means to him and kind of what his yardstick is, but if you guys have any questions about what it means to be a minimalist or how do you declutter your life? So we know how Josh decluttered his life, but what does that mean to us? So do you guys have any questions that for Josh specifically?
I was wondering about children and being minimalist and how there seems to be more and more stuff for children and you need this and that for children. And how do you reduce that without your child being an outcast or not having enough of, you know, or not having the same advantages as they start school?
Yeah, sure. That's a great question. I have two kids. My son is now 9 and my daughter is 5. So I know exactly what you're talking about and definitely live in that world of having kids. And I typically tell people that it is more difficult to be minimalist with kids, just like it's more difficult to be minimalist when you're married than if you're just living on your own. It adds new nuances and it adds more intentionality and just, you know, setting out, you know, some guidelines and doing those types of things with your kids. So it's difficult, but it's more important when you have kids, because I do believe that they're looking to you and they're noticing your example and they're noticing the life that you're living. I guess I've never felt that removing some of their unnecessary possessions. I mean, they still own some. I mean, they still have toys. My son's into sports and he has basketball and football. You know, I mean, he still has things. My daughter's into art and she has some art supplies. So it's not that we, you know, remove everything from their life, but instead we just remove the clutter. We try to remove this pursuit of consumerism and materialism and remove that out of their lives. And so I think that they are not disadvantaged in any way, but in fact have a great advantage going forward after seeing the life modeled I think the joy that you find living with less.
Thank you.
Great.
That's great. What about you, Lloyd? Do you have any questions for Joshua specifically? I think you're muted. Yeah, you got it.
Finally got it.
Click on the little microphone icon at the top of your Hangout.
Right. No.
Okay, finally, there we go. We gotcha.
Yeah, I finally got it. Okay. Between you and Leo, minimalism has just become a really, really big thing in the last couple of years. Mm-hmm. And I'm an architect, and it's sort of changed from the way I knew minimalism and talked minimalism, which was about design, mm-hmm. to almost like a spiritual rather than an intellectual and a sort of design tone. And I look at your site and some of the people you say I should read, and I was from the Dalai Lama on, and mm-hmm. was curious, how do you think this happened?
I think a couple things are coming into play. Number one, it's interesting when you begin studying the history of minimalism, studying the history of simplicity. Because I hear a lot of people say, you know, this new movement, what do you think is fueling this new movement? I think one of the things to remember is that this isn't new. You know, I have quotes on my site from thousands of years ago, you know, Henry David Thoreau recently and on through the centuries, most of the religious leaders from any generation have called people to pursue living with less and simplicity. So I don't think it's new in that area, but I do think that minimalists are able to find a voice today because of the internet and because of being able to put their message out there in new ways. It can become more of a mainstream message than maybe it could have, you know, from some guy living in a cabin, writing a book. You know, some people would stumble upon it, but minimalism, I think, offers this. The internet today offers that opportunity. And I have a friend of mine writing a book in London, and he talks about this post-materialistic world that right. we're living in, that we have had, you know, since the Industrial Revolution. We've had more and more things in our lives, more and more material possessions. They've become easier and easier to attain, and there's just this point now of it being so oversaturated and the realization that it hasn't improved our lives like like it promised it would, like all the advertisers promised that it would,
right.
That people are beginning to start looking elsewhere and are beginning to look new places to find happiness and joy, contentment, those types of things. Are, you know, a couple of the factors. I think technology is a factor. I have an iPhone, and you know, my iPhone's like a little Mary Poppins carpet bag. You know, I got maps in there, and books in there, and music in there, and movies in there. You know, my whole credit card's in there. My whole life, you know, can be controlled in the pocket of my hand. So I think that provides more opportunity to live with less today than it did even 5 years ago.
No, I've been writing a series on Treehugger basically called Your Office is in Your Pants. Basically,
oh, that's great.
You can get so much onto your cell phone now that you really, it's just going to flat screen monitors has shrunk the required footprint that we all need for our offices, and it's just getting smaller constantly.
Yeah, absolutely.
And Joshua, I had a question for you. I wonder if part of how we kind of got ourselves into this mess, if you will, are the larger houses. You know, I've visited folks who have, say, two kids but five bedrooms sort of houses, and then every bedroom has a bathroom, and then there's a guest bathroom, and there you go. And just talking, you know, within my own circle, I know part of what gets people away from minimal is having to furnish things that they have purchased or buy, you know, accessories to things that they thought they could have the one thing, and now they need to add things onto it. So if someone wants to kind of go minimal, like what are the big kind of steps that we should maybe take first and then kind of make the littler steps, if you will, fall into place?
Sure. You know, I typically challenge people to take the little steps first, but maybe that was just my journey, my specific journey. When I introduce this topic to people and call people to this idea of getting rid of possessions that they no longer need, that I think it sounds attractive to a lot of people.
Right.
But they typically jump to the hardest things. Well, what am I going to do about my grandma's china set? What am I going to do with all these sentimental items? What am I going to do with all my husband's stuff in the garage? You know, they jump to the hardest things, and I say don't start with the hardest things. Start with the easy stuff. There's plenty of things in your kitchen and in your closet, in the spare bedroom, in your office that you don't use, that you don't need. And I found that as we began getting rid of the easier things, we began experiencing more and more of this benefit, just the less stress and the less commitment, the less time cleaning, the less effort maintaining our stuff. We just began experiencing more and more of these benefits, which further propelled us to make the larger changes, moving to a smaller house, you know, getting rid of, you know, some of the sentimental things and beginning to set some of those boundaries. So for me, it worked the other way. It worked the other way around.
Good point. Good insight.
Yeah. But you're right on about the houses. I mean, that is and storage units. You know, it's
right.
It's a great one because we experienced that in our own life. Our first, we had a little one bedroom apartment. Then we had a two bedroom condo. Then we had a three bedroom house, and then a four bedroom house. And as you climb the social economic ladder, you know, you make a little bit more money. You research online. Well, 40% of your income should go to your mortgage. So you start doing the math. Okay, I can afford this much of a house. You know, I want to make this statement with what I own. And soon you got extra rooms. And every time we bought a new room, we had to buy new furniture to put in it. And it wasn't until we, you know, shrunk down then that we were even called to minimize more of our furniture and more of our possessions.
So Josh, we've talked a lot about stuff, right? So we're minimizing our stuff, and what does that mean? But you talk a lot about minimalism when it comes to your schedule and your time. So how do you balance having a life, having, you know, as you do public speaking events and having children and having a family and a job, how do you balance success and minimalism? How do you kind of trim down on that?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Good question, because I've never been one to call people to trim down on success. I'm not against work. I think work is important. I think positive work that contributes value to other people's lives is the kind of work that we should be doing and we should be focusing on. The first thing that I found when we began minimizing possessions, when we began removing our stuff, is that I had more time available to do things. The blog was a result of that. I don't think I would be able to find the time to write like I do today if I was still, you know, maintaining as much stuff as I maintained previously. And then as we began removing things, it just brought this new intentionality into our life in all facets of eating and how we spend our time and our appointments and commitments, even the things that we do, that we include our kids in. It brought that almost naturally into the conversation. I don't think I ever sat down and said, okay, now I got to get rid of a bunch of appointments and I got to get rid of a bunch of things that I do. It just was, yeah, why am I doing that? That's not adding value to me. That's not bringing joy to me. And we began removing those things, again, intentionally and specifically.
Right. Interesting.
That's great. Does anybody else have any questions for Josh? We're going to be here for maybe another 5 or 10 minutes or so. So if you have questions, Megan, Robin, Tarrant, Benjamin, great. If you have questions, just make sure that you click on your microphone button in your Hangout so that we can hear you.
Hey, Josh. I got a question.
Sure.
I feel like I sometimes do things that I think are well-intentioned, that I'm trying to save money. Like the example I'm thinking is I go to Sam's Club and I stock up on a lot of stuff. You know, I buy, pet food in bulk and all sorts of things in bulk, but paper towels, napkins. And so I have a place in my basement where I store all these things. And so on the one hand, I feel like I'm doing a good thing by saving trips to the store and buying all these things all at once and saving money. But at the other, you know, every time I walk in the basement, I feel like, you know, I'm preparing for the apocalypse or something. So it's like the exact opposite of minimalism.
Right.
What are your thoughts on that?
I always tell people to consider the hidden costs in their purchases. Mm-hmm. You buy an iPad and suddenly you got to buy the case that goes with it, the apps that go with it. Even if you don't have to buy them, you just find yourself drawn to purchasing them. There's financial hidden costs that go with each of our purchases, but there's also hidden emotional, energy-wise things. You buy a T-shirt, you got more things to organize in your closet. You got as you begin adding some of these things, there's a just for you. You know, sounds like you have this mind clutter, you know, going on. You may have saved the money, but every time you walk in your basement, you're like, man, why did I buy this much dog food, and you know, this over here is expired now after this length of time, and I think that we don't realize a lot of those hidden costs that go into our purchases. We just see the price tag and we weigh the price per serving, and I'm saving 2 cents per ounce on this purchase, and so it must be a good deal, as opposed to, you know, thinking through the bigger picture of, man, I just hate walking into my basement with right. 18 paper towel rolls sitting there.
Right, right.
How do you really get started and get buy-in from the rest of your family and doing a more simple life?
Yeah, that's a great one, and it certainly varies family by family. I can speak to your specific family. I can share my personal experience with it. As I mentioned, I was outside cleaning the garage, introduced to this idea of minimalism really for the first time. Someone said, hey, why don't you try living with less stuff? And so I went inside, and my wife had been spring cleaning the inside of the house. So I said, hey, you won't believe this conversation I just had with June. She said, we don't need to own all this stuff. And my wife's like, you know what? I think that's a good idea. Why don't you look into that? So she was on board with getting rid of things, and so we began systematically going room by room, removing things we didn't need. I like to say we removed about 60% of our things, and I wanted to keep going another 20%. You know, I was in 80% of the way, and she was in 60% of the way. And so we were all good until we reached this point, and then we had really this 20% of things where I had to learn patience. I had to learn grace, and it was okay, you know, for her to own some of these things. I started to see, you know, a little bit of friction, you know, in our relationship because of some of these things, and finally I had to let it go and say, well, I'm going to handle my things. I can get my things down to 80%. I love how far you've come. I wish you would go further, but I'm okay with where you are. And really, all relationships are that way. It's about compromise and determining the best way to live when you have two different worldviews living in the same family. Typically, I find there's a lot of common ground that people can find. Wives want their husbands to get rid of the things in the garage. Husbands want their wives to own less clothes. You know, but right. You can all agree on the extra set of Tupperware that's, you know, hidden in this drawer, just taking up space. So look for common ground, lead by example, and find grace and patience with your partner.
I think that's the hardest thing, because it's easier to find things that belong to somebody else that you could want to get rid of, but then you know, when it's your stuff, you're like, but I really like that. It means a lot to me.
Yeah, but, exactly.
You know, the weird bird statue means nothing to me.
We have a hard time putting our emotions onto other people, and they appreciate things the way we appreciate different things. Good point.
So, kind of funny, this is the face of darkness from beyond. I'm going minimalist with power, evidently, because I've lost power. We are in the middle of tornadoes, so I thought you would find the irony pretty funny. So,
that is crazy. I saw your screen go black.
Yeah. So if anybody has any other questions, please ask Josh. Otherwise, I think we're gonna wrap it up. And by all means, after the Hangout, please send us more questions, send Josh questions on Google+. But if you have any other questions, just kind of speak now or forever hold your peace. Hope, I think you may be on mute.
Sorry, am I there now?
Yep, you're here.
So one question I would just have, Joshua, you know, for those of us who are in the U.S. and who are in Canada, is it harder for folks in countries like ours, do you think, to live the minimal lifestyle? Is that tougher than someone who's, say, living in, you know, even Spain or, you know, Brazil? Is there something about our culture that you think makes it especially difficult?
I have never lived in Spain. I think that, you know, if you track American history, the growth of the suburb after World War II really kind of cemented, furthered this consumeristic lifestyle that we live in. Suburbia tended to separate us a little bit more from our neighbors, a little less living together, close quarters, bigger houses. I think that began to contribute to this consumerism society that we do live in. So that's a big one, and as opposed to city versus suburb. You know, America is incredibly inundated by commercialism and advertisements. Statistics will say the average American sees 5,000 advertisements a day. Every single one of them, you know, are promising that your life will be better by investing in this or buying this or purchasing this, spending your money here. So it's something that we are called to over and over again. And certainly I tend to tell people that I think deep down we don't want to live consumeristic lifestyles. Most of us don't deep down want to be burdened by all the things that we own. We've just bought into the life far more than we realize that we've ever bought into it.
Got it.
Hope.
Yes.
If I actually wanted to jump in, if I can make a comment,
yeah, that'd be great.
A bit of an answer to that. I have a good friend who uses a phrase all the time: small fridges make good cities. And his whole point is that, you know, when you have a small fridge or you live in a small place and you don't have a lot of storage, you're out much more being part of your community, shopping more often, going to the corner store. And that's the big difference you find in Spain and in France. I find that people are out there. There's 15 grocery stores within walking distance. They don't have 30 rolls of toilet paper like Benjamin does because they don't have a place to put it. So you go out and you're part of your community, and they don't have 4 foot wide double fridges either.
Right.
Sure, and they don't have two or three car garages where you never have to even, you know, get out of your car. You push your button and drive into your house and push the button and never talk to your neighbors.
Right.
That's right. That's a very good insight. Well, Joshua, thank you. And your blog, Becoming Minimal, is a great resource, I think, as well. So, Lisa, I think I know you're there in the dark, but
I'm here in the dark. Broadcasting live from Minimal Power. So thank you, Josh, so much for joining us. If you guys are watching the video and you want to join the Year of Living Simply, just go to MNN.com. I'll also have the link associated with this event, and we'll have the link in the comments of this video. So thanks again, and we'll see you guys next month.
All right, great.
Thanks so much for having me.
Bye-bye. Thank you.